In this example, we're going to work a very easy definite integral problem, primarily just to get our feet wet with the notation and how to work these definite integral problems and what the answer means and those sorts of things. We'll do some more complicated videos coming up in the later videos, but for now, we're just trying to get our feet wet. So here we go. We want to compute the definite integral from minus 1 to 3 of the function x plus 2. X plus 2 is this linear function here. And we're integrating from negative 1 up to 3 right here. Now, what does this notation mean? Well, this means the area under the curve down to the x-axis or above the x-axis from x is minus 1 to x being 3. So we learned a great calculus way to do this in the last video called the Fundamental Theorem of Calculus. And just a quick reminder, here's what it says in short. It says if you want to find the area under f of x from a to b, what you have to do is find the antiderivative of little f and plug in the terminal point minus the antiderivative of f where you plug in the initial point and subtract those two, and then that's the area under the curve. Okay, so let's do that. The antiderivative of x plus 2, we can just integrate these independently, right, from sum and difference rule. So the integral of x would be x squared over 2 using the power rule for integration, and the integral of 2 would be 2x for the constant rule of integration. So once you have the antiderivative, the common notation is we'll put a bracket on the right hand side with a minus 1 and a 3. And what this tells the reader is, all right, in just a second, we're going to plug in 3 and we're going to plug in minus 1 and we'll subtract those two quantities. That just keeps you from writing stuff, you know, all over the place. All right, so here we go. Let's plug in 3 and then let's plug in negative 1 and then we'll see what two numbers we'll get and we'll subtract. So if you plug in a 3, let's try to do a little mental math here. 3 squared is 9. 9 over 2 would be 4.5 or 4.5. And then 2 times 3 is 6. So 6 and 4.5, I'll just use decimal notations. This would be 10.5. You could, of course, write it as a fraction if you wanted to. And then if we plug in negative 1, negative 1 squared is positive 1 divided by 2 makes a half. So we have a half minus 2 because that's 2 times negative 1. So a half minus 2 is negative 3 halves. In other words, negative 1.5 if you wrote it as a decimal. But again, like, you don't have to. You could have written negative 3 halves there. Simplify this difference. A minus a negative will create a plus. 10.5 plus 1.5 makes a total of 12, right? Now, what's 12? Well, using the Fundamental Theorem of Calculus, we've shown that the area under this curve here is a total of 12 square units of area. 12 square units of area. So if this was feet, it'd be 12 square feet. If it was inches, it'd be 12 square inches, et cetera, et cetera. But this 12 is representing area. All right. Now let's look at this the old way, just for comparison's sake. Before we knew about the Fundamental Theorem of Calculus, again, because this example is so easy, we could have done this in a roundabout, geometrical way, just using algebra and geometry to do this. Knowing that we're looking for the area under the curve, we could have just broken this up into a rectangle and a triangle, found their areas, and add them together. So let's just do that real quick and just convince ourselves that these numbers are going to match. The area of this rectangle on the bottom would be the width, which is 4 from minus 1 to 3. That's a distance of 4 units, times its height, which if you notice, this has a height of 1. And then the area of the triangle would be 1/2 base times height. Again, the base is 4. And the height, if you look at this triangle, the height is also 4. So this would give you 1/2 times 4 is 2. 2 times 4 makes 8. And 4 times 1 is 4. So if you add 8 and 4 together, the area of the triangle and the rectangle together, we would see that this definite integral, again, has an area of 12, the same as what we got before. Now, from here on out, we'll probably never, ever do it this way again, because this only worked because these were nice geometrical shapes. If your function has a smooth top that's curving and bending, There's no nice geometry formulas for things that look like that because they're not triangles, they're not rectangles, they're not circles and things of that nature. So I did this just to convince you that this fundamental theorem of calculus is working as it should, and it's a great tool to use. So now we'll move on and look at some more complicated examples, more on par with what you would more likely see on a homework assignment or like a test.